Quick mic check. Can the folks out in the very back hear me? If you can hear me in the back, go woo! Oh man, I don't think you can hear me. Well, that's all right. So let's have a little fun with that, actually. We're here in beautiful Santa Monica, California. How many folks were from the Southern California area? Didn't have to go very far to get here. Woo! All right, how many folks come from anywhere in the United States to be here? Okay, nice. Anybody from outside the United States? Oh, a few folks had to fly across the ocean. Nice, nice. I love it. Okay, hey, how many people use an iPhone just for fun? Woo! Okay, how many people use an Android? Woo! All right, about any flip phones out there? I'm still waiting for the person brave enough to admit they've got a flip phone in their pockets. So far, nobody. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to talk about something that's near and dear to my heart, super important. It's how to crush your competition. But I'm going to change the title to outsmart your competition. Am I going the wrong way? I'm going to change the title to outsmart your competition. Because you know that old joke with the guys in the woods trying to outrun the bear? The two of them run as fast as they can. They're being chased by a bear. And the one guy says, hey, do you think we can outrun the bear? And the other guy says, well, I'm just trying to outrun you. Right? So it's not about crushing your competition. It's about outsmarting your competition. It's about working smarter than they do and getting out in front of them. So first, I want to tell you a quick story. I love shopping at Target, but pretend you're shopping at whatever your favorite store is. The way in-store experiences have always worked is like this. You walk in, and you see what you're looking for. You push your cart around. You figure out what you want to buy. And as you're trying to figure out what you're going to buy and fill your cart, you're going to pass hundreds and thousands of products. You're going to see stuff you didn't intend to buy. You're going to fill up your cart with not only what you came there to get, but also all the stuff you didn't come there to get. Because you're going to pass right past all the aisles and think, oh, I need some shampoo. And by the way, just a quick aside, does the world really need this many flavors of shampoo? I mean, honestly. But the point is, you're going to see all that stuff, right? And you're going to stick it in your cart, and you're going to check out. And it's not even done when you're checking out, because at the checkout stand, you're going to see this, the barrage of brands and choices and products. The enticement to stick things into your cart does not end until you've finally gone to the cash register, checked out, and gone to your car. Now, that's the in-store way. That's the way the real world works, right? Now, I would like to take you into Crazy Pants Cuckoo Land and talk about a magical imaginary Target. In Crazy Pants Cuckoo Land, there's an imaginary Target that works like this. You walk into it, and every single product is invisible. It looks like this. Every single product in this crazy cuckoo Target is invisible. Hang on a second. Is invisible. And what you have to do is you have to walk into the Target with all the invisible products, and you have to shout out what you're there for. Fluoride toothpaste with little mint chips in them, or whatever your favorite kind of toothpaste is, right? And then the magical Target goes through and turns visible all the things that it thinks matches. And then you take a look at those things and go, yeah, that's the one I wanted, right? That is crazy. Imagine if you walked into a real Target, a physical store, everything was invisible, and they made you shout out what you were looking for, and then they turned on 15 things that they think match. You wouldn't go, oh, perfectly normal. This is just like any other shopping day. I'll take that and check out. Thank you very much. No, you go like, what the heck did I just walk into? This is cuckoo, right? But this is exactly how we buy stuff every single day online. This is normal online, right? It's absolutely crazy. So the challenge is that if you don't say the exact right words as a consumer, the right things that you're looking for aren't going to turn on. But really, should we expect the consumer to have to do all the work to make sure they say the right words? Or does that fall on us, the marketers, the brand owners, the sellers, the merchants? Does that fall on us? So I want to show you a quick story real quick, a little quick commercial that I love. And this is just a quick 30-second commercial. Listen to it because it's going to drive my main point home.
Das hier ist mein Sektor.
Das hier ist das wichtigste Gerät des Küstenwächters.
Das Gerät und das Gerät.
Überlebensradar.
Mayday, Mayday. Hello, can you hear us? Can you hear us? Can you... Over. We are sinking. We are sinking.
Hello? This is the German Coast Guard.
We are sinking. We're sinking.
What are you thinking about?
It drives the point home, and that is words matter. Words absolutely, positively matter. The meaning of words, the context of words, the moral of this story is your words as a marketer, as a brand owner, as a merchant, as a seller, you, as a manufacturer, your words have to equal your customers' words. If you remember only one thing about seeing me here today, it's your words have to be the customer's words. Don't expect your customers to start describing things the way you choose to describe them, the way you have always been describing them. You have to take the step to figure out how your customers are describing them. I was just chatting with Forrest earlier, and he said that he bought a loft bed for his kids. I hope Forrest doesn't mind me telling this story. But he said he was trying to looking online to buy a loft bed for his kids, and he didn't know that it was called a loft bed. So he's typing into Amazon, bed up high, bed in the air, raised beds, which produced a whole different set of results, right? But he could never find what he was looking for until his wife finally said, dude, that's a loft bed. Search for loft bed, and you got it. This illustrates two interesting points. Number one is women are generally smarter than men, I think. This proves that theory. But the second thing is customers search the way customers search. Merchants should figure out and marketers should figure out exactly how to make their descriptions of the product match what the people are looking for. So, how do I discover what my customers' words are? Man, any way you possibly can is the answer to that question. Listen to your customers. Outright ask your customers. Eavesdrop on a customer's conversation. I know this is kind of weird, but sometimes I like actually just hang out in my local Target, you know, the real one, and if I'm interested to find if I'm using the right keywords when I'm describing or marketing or selling a product, I'll stand in the aisle where that product's being sold, and I'll just kind of loiter, and I'll hear people talk about it. Oh, hey, did you, and as they're talking about the product that I'm researching, they will use phrases and words that would have never occurred to me otherwise, because I'm not in their head, they're in their head, but the way I listen to what's going on in their head is by just simply listening to them. Now, let's pretend you're marketing barf bags, all right? We're just gonna pretend for a minute. Is there anybody here with actually marketing barf bags? Anyone? Oh, that would be, yeah, really? Seriously? Okay, no, I just, wouldn't that be cool though? Right. So let's pretend, just as an example, you're marketing barf bags, right? If my job was to describe the marketing copy or the listing in the marketplace or on my .com, if I was trying to describe all the content for barf bags, my exposure to barf bags is mostly in an airplane. I see them every time I travel. They're sitting right there in the little thing right in front of me. In fact, seeing them kind of makes me a little nauseous, but whatever. So I look at them and I'm like, okay, airline travel, sickness, nausea, throw up, vomit, all these kinds of things is what would occur to me. Now, if I went to Amazon and looked at some of the Amazon reviews, I would peek right inside the mind of other customers. Now, here's someone here, I don't know if you can read it, but I'll read it, I'll point out some of these words for you. Here's a customer who was describing some barf bags she bought online, and she says, these bags are coming handy for me in my pregnancy. They fit perfectly well in my purse. I always keep one on by my bed for morning and night sickness, and they are leak-proof. Those are words that, as my experience with barf bags go, I would have never, ever, ever thought of, right? But they were sitting right there in Amazon for me to just look, eavesdrop, listen to that person's review of the product. The customer words were just right there. There's another tool, it's my company makes it, and what we do is we figure out the words people use when they shop online. I'm partial to it because I wrote it, but the thing about it is, if you use any kind of way to get inside the minds of your customers, a tool like the one my company sells, or talking to customers directly, or any possible way, just get inside the minds of a customer and figure out how they shop for things. Now, I want to quickly tell you about a success story. I met a super nice lady, her name's Elena, she runs a website called Bling Jewelry. Hope you can see it there at the top, yep, there's the title of her website. If you're in the market to buy some jewelry, go to blingjewelry.com, buy one from Elena, she's super nice. But I bumped into her and she said, hey, I want to tell you this interesting story. When I discovered your product, I had a particular problem I was looking to solve, and I took in a lot of inventory of anklets, you know, the bracelets for your ankle. I took a lot of inventory of anklets and I was trying to get them to sell, and I was a little bit nervous because they weren't selling very well. So I discovered your little tool, and I understand your approach. We gotta, you know, your craft words have to be your customer's words. I get it. So I fired up your tool, I did a search for anklet, and your tool suggested that, apart from anklet, the next two words I should try in my content is hot wife anklet and swinger anklet. And so she looks at me and she says, now at first I wondered what the heck you were up to, what was I getting into, what kind of person or website or company are you all about? And then she said, but you know what, I'm gonna go out on a limb, and I decided to give it a try. I decided to see if this little experiment would work. And she didn't put any of these content on her website, and she didn't put it any place where a customer could see it, like in the Amazon description, but she fired up her Amazon listing for all of the anklets she's selling, and she put it in the back-end keywords. I don't know how many of you guys actually list product on Amazon if you have someone do it for you in your outfit, but in Amazon you can have back-end keywords that only match the search algorithm, they don't actually show to the user. So she put those into her back-office keywords. And what she told me was, the very next day after she did that, she went from couldn't sell a single one of these stupid anklets to now I can't keep them in stock. So the interesting thing to me was, nothing I built or a tool that I wrote helped manufacture demand for anklets. Nothing she did manufactured demand for anklets. None of this manufactured the demand. The demand was always there. The difference was, plenty of people were searching for just plain old anklet when they were shopping online. But a ton of people were searching for swinger anklet and hot wife anklet. Oh, and by the way, I'm really not part of the swinger community, but they tell me that if you wear it on one side, it means a certain thing, and if you wear it on the other side, it means a certain thing. I don't know, right? I don't know if anyone here wants to tell us what that means, but the thing of it is, if you're ever at a beach and you're wearing an anklet on one side or the other, watch out. One side means something, the other side means something else. I don't know what it is. Do your research before you go to a clothing optional beach. You've been warned. But the point is, the kind of the moral of this story is, she had no idea there were people searching for swinger anklets. I had no idea people were searching for swinger. Nobody had any idea that people were searching for swinger anklets, right? Unless, except the people searching for swinger anklets. But once we discovered that, once we were able to peek inside the mind of the customer, then she changed her description of the product to match. And the interesting little wrinkle here is, she didn't actually rebrand her product. She didn't change the description. She changed nothing about the customer-facing aspect of her product at all. It's just how she was marketing it and then connected with that audience she was missing. So, I chatted with somebody. He's like, yeah, but I just don't get it. I just don't get it. And then he pushed that guy aside and said, oh, but I want to tell you about something that happened to me when I used to work for a company called Jacob from WeWork. He's not here, but Jacob from WeWork pushed me aside once at a conference and said, tell everybody on stage that one simple tweak makes a big difference, because I once worked for a company where we changed the word vacation to holiday and we saw 1,000 times increase in traffic. So this kind of stuff is real and can have an amazing and immediate impact. My quick closing thing for you is, my little company, Merchant Words, we make an existing, the tool we have right now, the existing tool that we have, if you look at our website, it's a simple little tool. We don't charge much, $30, and we're actually knocking that down for a great discount if you want to try us out. What we do is we help mostly merchants, a little bit of marketers or some of our customers, but mostly merchants figure out how to describe their products on their own .com website and in Amazon or wherever they're selling to better connect with their customers. Just like Elena from Bing Jewelry and thousands of other folks, they use our tool in addition to some also offline ways to get inside the mind of the customer and figure out how to best connect with them. What we're working on, and what I'd love your help with, and I'm actually not selling it, it's all free, and but I need your help. We're working on a content tool. And this is why I kind of need your help to let me know if we're building the right tool. We're working on a content tool that lets you take your marketing copy, any kind of content, the content in your email, whatever it is, and then run it through our algorithms. We'll check to see how many of those phrases and terms and words and ways you're describing things connect with customers when they're shopping, and how many of them don't. It's a way for you to help optimize your marketing copy. That's going to go into private beta very soon, and I would love to have you help me test it. It's no cost, no sign up, no, just all free, but I'd love to have you help me test and give me your feedback, see if it works for you. If you would like to engage with us and either connect with me or ask me a question about anything, I'll be here for a little while, but if you miss me here physically at the show, connect with me on Facebook or shoot me an email. I would love to connect with you. Facebook's sometimes easier because my inbox gets overloaded. If you friend me on Facebook, though, you might have to look at my vacation picture, so careful, caution about that. But if you go to merchantwords.com/digimarkon, just let me know that you're interested. I would love to have you take a look at our existing tool, which is primarily geared toward merchants, but I really need your help to see if we're building the right tool for marketers as well. So that's it. I'll be happy to take any questions. I think we have about 2 or 3 minutes left. I'll be happy to chat with you after outside at my table. But in a nutshell, that's what I have to say. What was the most important thing I wanted you to remember today? The one thing? Your customers' words have to be your words. Please, please, please do everything you can to connect with the people shopping for you, but connect with them in the exact same way that they're searching for you. Let their words be your words. That's my message. Thanks very much for listening. I appreciate it. Thank you.